As you can see, the agenda consists of several talks in the morning. We have a keynote speaker. The times are going to be shifted, I guess, by about 20 minutes. We have lunch that will be served here. During lunch and during the coffee breaks, you will be able to walk around and watch the student electronic poster presentations. So we'll get started. Each talk is about 20 minutes. I will keep time, and we'll go about 18 minutes. I will give you a sign, and you'll wrap it up, and we'll have a time for one or two questions. I'll have to put my glasses on. Okay, the first talk is by, and by the way, the program that you have has all the bios, so I'm going to skip bios introduction. The first talk is by Dr. Clewer, Advances in Error Control Strategies for 5G.
Now, I think the theme today is 5G, at least in the first part of the session here, the first couple of talks. So, and I'll talk about error control strategies in 5G. So before talking about error control codes, so we have to talk about the requirements for 5G. Okay, yeah. Before we talk about error control codes, we have to first talk about the requirements. So in 5G, what is projected that we have 10,000 times more traffic. We actually have 10 to 100 times more devices connected than right now in 4G. The latency has been reduced by factor 10 to 1 millisecond, and the battery life for mobile-to-mobile or basically machine-to-machine communication should grow by factor 10 to 10 years. So also the data rate goes up significantly. If you look at the data rate here, that's 10 gigabits per second. So right now we have 100 megabits in fourth generation. So really, there's a big challenge actually, big changes and big challenges also to the hardware. So and to see that, let's look at the following simple figure. So the current cost of computational cost of transmission is approximately 6 nanojoules per bit, right? So, and if I look at my iPhone 6, the battery capacity is 6.9 watts per hour. If you have a target of 10 gigabits per second, so how long can we actually browse the internet with this? So it turns out that we can browse the internet for 5 minutes and 27 seconds, and clearly everybody would complain if your cell phone dies after this time. So I think we have to change something. So we have to change, first of all, the battery life will increase up to in terms projected up to 2020. But also we have to look at more low complexity communication setups, more complexity communication strategies. And one way is that error correction also has to take its share to become more low complexity. So what has happened in channel coding for STAR-G? So there's a quantum leap from 2G to 3G. With the adoption of modern iteratively decoded codes like Turbo codes and LDPC codes. So 2G uses Reed Solomon codes like block codes people have used for 30 years. 3 to 4G, basically the same technique. What was new is the adoption of hybrid ARQ. So basically hybrid ARQ introduces some feedback and the decoder tells the encoder, hey, please send me more bits. I cannot really decode what you've sent me because there's so much channel noise. So we have an adaptive coding rate for 4G. So, but for 5G, in order to satisfy these stringent requirements, we need actually paradigm changing coding, right? So it's not just enough to move on with what we have in 4G. So what is our wish list for 5G? So we know that 3G, 4G codes, they are capacity approaching for the point-to-point binary input AWGN channel. So those codes actually are already at the theoretical predicted minimum, very close to this actually. So, but however, what we want to know is we want to gain, we want to have be more power efficient in terms of our transmission. So we have to find coding for spectrally efficient communication, and coding specially adapted to spectral efficiency. And also we have to look at multi-terminal coding and decoding. And there has been nothing done so far, only a little bit done. So many, basically all codes are for the point-to-point channel. And so the multi-terminal setup is still wide open. And I think we expect significant savings from this. Also, we have to look at gains in computational power efficiency, basically low complexity decoding, low complexity encoding. So is there any code, so basically if you look at this, is there any code which ticks all these boxes, or any single coding scheme which stands out and say, hey, we could use that. So is there one code which actually fits all? Unfortunately, this is not the case. So one size does not fit all. So we have to have several strategies, several coding strategies, which are candidates. And in particular, there's basically coupled convolutional LDPC codes I talk about today a bit, how they work. Non-binary LDPC codes and polar codes. So polar codes I maybe skip because in interest of time. So how do things work? So if you look at LDPC block codes, LDPC stands for low density parity check codes, and I'll tell you in a second what low density means. So basically we see what we have here, vertical is the bit error probability, and horizontally is the channel noise, right? So and what we want is we want to have a very low bit error probability, so 10 to the minus 11 to the minus 12 for data transmission. And we have the channel limit. And we cannot really communicate on this side of the channel limit. So there is really no way to communicate here on this side. We can actually only communicate on this side. So we also see that we have the result if you don't apply any channel code. If you don't apply any channel code, we get this curve here, this dash curve. And if you apply to different kinds of LDPC codes, and we get different behaviors. And I'm not interested in the codes so far. I'm just interested in behavior. So typically, every code performance drops rapidly down to a very low error probability if you increase the channel SNR. But some, for example, this code has, that is actually called, we call this waterfall region here. But there's also some problem here. We see actually there's an error floor, which actually means that there's this change in slope of the curve. And we actually want to, typically want to operate our code in this regime. So you see that this code, the irregular LDPC code, this curve is not really very suitable. So instead, we have to go to regular codes, which don't have an error floor, but have a worse threshold. It's further away from the channel limit from our theoretical predicted minimum. Right? So now what we want to do is we want to combine, or especially coupled codes actually combine both the good best of both worlds. They have a good threshold and have the absence of an error floor. So just to understand what coding means, so this is a tanner graph of regular LDPC code. So this is a parity check matrix. So what the rows of this matrix denote the parity check equation. So in this case, we have 10 bits, we transmit 10 bits, 10 code bits, and the code bits have to check, have to satisfy all these equations. Each equation is a row, and we see also that this matrix has exactly 3 ones in each row, and in its column, and 6 ones in each row, and we can actually come up with this graph here. And this graph actually tells us the connection of this matrix in a way that these are the check nodes, these are the 5 check equations, indicated by the row of this matrix, by the rows of this matrix, and they are connected to some of the code bits here, right? And what we do, how we decode, so the code bits are noisy, some bits are flipped maybe, we decode back and forth on this graph iteratively, and what we pass on this graph are probabilities for individual bits. So we have iterative decoding, you see it's very low complexity, the complexity is only, scales only with the block length, linearly with the block lengths here. And of course, this is a very small code, right? Typically, you don't want to transmit 10 bits. You want to transmit 100 bits, 1,000 bits, 10,000 bits. This matrix gets very, very big. It's a sparse matrix because the number of ones in each column and ones in each row stays the same. So we have sparse codes, and the sparsity is actually the property, the nice property. Talk about spatially coupled codes. Have been invented as convolutional LDPC codes. 1999, and then 10 years, nothing happened. So basically, this result was completely ignored. Some people worked on this, but the breakthrough came in 2010, where Kudeka, Richard Nobanke, looked at the theory of these codes. And then basically, this sparked off a big boost in research, making those codes suitable for 5G. They have a very nice feature because they are universally capacity achieving for a wide range of channels. That means if I design a code for one channel within a specific class of channels, I can use it for another channel too, without ever changing the design. They have a nice property, threshold saturation. What it actually means is that, as I said, they combine the best of both worlds, they have a good threshold, and they don't have any error flow. So, and the decoding complexity can be very low because we can look at windowed decoding, we can reduce the latency and the complexity, and I'll talk about this briefly in a second. So how is this code constructed, actually? So we use unwrapping. So basically, we take a matrix of a block code here, and cut and paste it, and put it like this, and then arrange these fractions here, arrange it on this diagonal, on this matrix here, right? So, and you can see the code still has the same properties because it still has 3 ones in each row in its column and 6 ones in each row, right? So it's the same property. But now this is kind of a semi-infinite matrix here. So it's a kind of streaming code now. It has a convolutional structure. So basically, it takes data and puts out code bits. So it's a kind of ideal for streaming. So it's really like an infinite matrix goes infinite in both directions. Now, we can come up with a resulting tensor graph. As for the LDPC code we've just seen, we can come up with this graph here. Again, it's semi-infinite. It goes infinite in this direction and infinite in this direction. And you see it's a regular graph because it looks really regular. Each segment here has the same structure. But typically, each communication ends at some point. We have to terminate the graph, and we get this result. So, and if you look again at this here, you see that at the end, now we have a slight irregularity here, right? It's not regular anymore. It's regular in the middle, but at the end, it's slightly irregular. And that actually is the reason why these codes perform so well. You can show this irregularity. Slight irregularity makes this code very, very powerful. So now this is the gain we get. You see the red curve is for LDPC block codes. And now if you spatially couple them by the approach I just mentioned, we get the Brook curve, right? And we see this big gain, this convolutional gain, which is really significant here. We get actually for free, right? We don't have any extra cost in decoding, any extra cost in encoding. We get this gain for free. So, and this actually shows, this is a bit complicated. Let me just talk about the left-hand side here in the interest of time. So this shows that these codes actually are asymptotically capacity achieving. Here we have, again, the channel SNR. Here we have the code rate. The code rate tells us how much redundancy we add. A large code rate means we add less redundancy. A low code rate means we add a lot of redundancy. This is Shannon limit. So again, there's no way to operate in this part of the curve here. We can only operate here. And let's just look at the green curve, red curve here. So this is, if you look at the performance for the corresponding block code, for the 4-8 code, 4 ones in each column, 8 ones in each row, we get this performance here. And now if we couple them, and L is the termination length, the length of this coupled graph, we see actually we approach the Shannon limit, we get actually up to capacity if L gets very big. These codes have very great properties, and that's actually exactly what we want. So let me skip the decoding in the interest of time. Let me just look at the window decoding. What we can do is actually, this is again the tensor graph. It's a slightly different sketch here, but it's the same tensor graph of a coupled code. We can actually take a small window and slide the window over the graph, and basically only the window length is the latency of our scheme, and also this reduces complexity here. Right, so there are other codes, for example, non-binary LDPC codes. They work, as the name says, non-binary in GFQ. And now the code alphabet can be equivalent to the modulation alphabet. If we have, for example, 16 QAM, we can actually have a code which works in this field, you know, and we can directly encode the modulation symbols, actually. So the performance is better at low block length than binary codes. Decoding complexity is order Q log Q, so it's still not too big. And again, in this graph, now we pass messages not related to bits, but related to symbols over a finite field. So how do these codes perform? And interestingly, let's look at this performance here for random codes. The block length is moderate here. So this is the result for binary codes, right? And if we increase the field size, we see a significant performance gain here, up to GF16. So it gets by several orders of magnitude. This is a frame error rate. It's the error for the whole block. We also see we introduce some modification of the code, which can do even better here, which by indicated by the red curve. And this is for a structured code. These are random codes. This is for a structured code, a quasi-cyclic code. And we see that for a structured code, we can approximately get the same performance than random codes, but for approximately half the block length. So these codes have very, very good properties in terms of error probability. Of course, it's the expense of slightly higher decoding complexity. So now, polar codes, just very briefly, it's the first constructive technique to provably achieve channel capacity with bounded complexity. They are block codes, they're related to Reed-Muller codes, and they're constructed recursively. The nice thing is why I mentioned them here, because they have advantages for multi-terminal setups. So at the beginning said 5G requirements are also that we have to code for multi-terminal structure, so broadcast setups, so one node broadcast to several guys. And this actually is where polar codes have an advantage, so they are capacity achieving, for example, for the broadcast channel. So how much time I have? Okay, great. So basically now, what are the takeaways? So what are the 5G requirements? So does one code fit them all? Does one code tick all the boxes? Not really. So this is a comparison of different codes. For example, this is the code we discussed today. So let's look at low complexity encoding and decoding. Clearly binary special coupled codes are great. Non-binary LDPC codes, polar codes, so and so. Final block length performance, I forgot to mention, polar codes are really bad. That's why they're not practical currently. But they are, final block length performance of non-binary LDPC code is better. Spectrally efficient, well, non-binary LDPC codes can be adapted to any modulation easily. Polar codes, we can do it non-binary too, but the final block length scaling gets worse. And suitable for multi-terminal setups, that's one of the key requirements in 5Gs. And that's why I really mentioned the polar codes, because the polar codes really have an advantage here. They're really great for multi-terminal setups, but these other codes are really not that great. It's more difficult to show the corresponding properties because they're mathematically much more difficult to handle than polar codes. So basically, what do we conclude? Well, the best thing would be, or there are two things actually, two conclusions. First of all, final block length performance of polar codes, if we could improve that while keeping the multi-terminal feature here, that would be really great because we would have some gains here. But essentially, non-binary spatial coupled LDPC codes, we combine these two properties. That might be a good candidate for future 5G coding schemes because they actually have the best of both worlds. And this ends my talk. I would just want to give you a list of publications related to the area. I co-authored with many other people to thank them all for their work. And thanks a lot.